Okay, I'm going to ask everyone to be seated, and we're now going to call to meeting the order of the Senate Judiciary Committee. It is now 20 after 12, and we're going to start with Judge Stein. I welcome her, ask her to take her seat, and take a deep breath and relax, and give us a little bit of your qualifications, and share with us any thoughts that you would like the committee to know about you.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Senator Michael Thompson, members of the committee, friends and colleagues. I would first like to thank my friends and colleagues, including my wonderful Presiding Justice Honorable Karen Peters, and my appellate division chamber staff, that's Rose Jude Clark and Regina Martino, who are here today, for their encouragement and support. I especially want to acknowledge my husband, Mark Saunders, for his love and for all that he does to make it possible for me to meet my responsibilities of my position. I am grateful to the governor for having nominated me to be an associate justice judge of the Court of Appeals, and I am honored to have the opportunity to appear before this committee to seek your recommendation for Senate confirmation of that nomination. Please permit me to tell you a little about what has brought me to this moment. As a child growing up in Westchester County, I had many role models, including my grandfather and my parents, all of whom were lawyers. Although one might think that I was expected to follow in their footsteps, particularly being the oldest of three children, in fact, the only expectations of which I was aware were that I complete my education and that I excel at whatever I chose to do. While I did not appreciate that the law was my calling until I completed college, I'm certain that the countless legal discussions that took place around the family dinner table led me in that direction. Perhaps even more significantly, my parents taught me the importance of community involvement and public service. My father was active in numerous organizations, including his synagogue and the Rotary Club. His sister has often remarked that he didn't belong to any organization of which he did not eventually become its president. My mother was also a leader. In addition to raising a family and pursuing her career, serving the constituents of two members of Congress and working as an attorney in the New York State Attorney General's office, she was always engaged in service to community and professional organizations, including the PTA, the League of Women Voters, the Women's Bar Association, and innumerable member committees and task forces. I have tried to follow in my parents' footsteps of engaging in public and community service. Upon graduation from college, I entered law school, eventually graduating second in my class from Albany Law School. Like many law students, I explored a variety of employment opportunities. I decided to pursue public service because my parents had instilled in me the value of giving back to my community. I applied for and was offered a position in the court system as a law clerk to two family court judges in the Schenectady family. After a two-year tenure in that position, I pursued an opportunity to work in the private practice of law to further broaden my experience. I accepted a position in the Family and Matrimonial Law Department of the Albany Law Firm of McNamee Law Firm Tyson Williams, where I remained for over 13 years, eventually becoming a partner. In time, I missed the call to public service, and I was appointed to fill a vacancy in the Albany City Court. Then in 1997, I was elected to that position. During my 5 years as a city court judge, I expanded my knowledge of both civil and criminal law and gained the experience that prepared me to become a Supreme Court judge. As a trial judge in Supreme Court, I was exposed to a variety of areas of law, first serving in Columbia and Greene counties, and later as the presiding judge of the Integrated Domestic Violence Court in Rensselaer County. After sitting for 6 years as a Supreme Court trial judge, I was honored to be appointed to serve on the Appellate Division Third Department, where for the past 7 years, I have continued to study and learn the law. While I had the time, missed the trial bench, I have found that being an appellate judge provides me with an endless opportunity to grow intellectually. I have also found the responsibility of serving on an appellate court to be different from that of being a trial court judge, and that appellate judges must consider the implications of each decision, not only on the individual cases before us, but also on other cases that may follow. I take that responsibility seriously, and I address each case with the singular goal of arriving at a just and legally correct result. As a jurist, I appreciate the separation of powers envisioned by the founders of our democracy. As such, I have always sought to impartially interpret and fairly apply the laws enacted by the legislature and enforced by the executive branch of government. I strive to be ever mindful of the distinct roles served by each branch of government, and I approach each case with an open mind in adherence to existing legal precedent. I also recognize the impact the law has on all aspects of people's lives and the importance of rendering clear and understandable decisions upon which lawyers and litigants can rely. I believe my record demonstrates that I have the necessary intellect, temperament, work ethic, and common sense to serve on this state's highest court. I have now stood for election and appointment to judicial positions on more than one occasion. Each time, I have been highly rated by the applicable judicial screening committees and by various professional organizations. I submit to you that the unique combination of my academic successes, work ethic, commitment to public service, experience in private practice and in all levels of the state court system, together with my dedication to fairness, have prepared me well and made me well suited to become a court of appeals judge. I would consider that position as the ultimate opportunity to serve the citizens of New York State. It is a great privilege, honor, and responsibility to be a judge. I am humbled by the opportunity to continue to serve the public as an associate judge of the Court of Appeals. If confirmed, I assure you that I will be ever mindful of the weighty responsibility of this office. I would be honored to serve on the court. Thank you for considering my nomination.
Thank you, Judge Stein. We've been joined by Senator Vello, and I also have Senator Panapinto, who is not a member of the Judiciary Committee, but all senators are always welcome to the Judiciary Committee. At this time, I'd like to open it up to the members that have any questions of Judge Stein. Excuse me. You want to start? Senator Thompson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Judge Stein, can you tell us briefly your view of the Drug Law Reform Act of 2009, better known as Rockefeller Drug Law?
I have certainly had occasion to apply that law in certain cases, and as with any case, I seek to apply it to the facts of that case, and in terms of legislation and whether it should be approved or whether other changes might be appropriate, I think that's really for you all, for the legislature, to determine, but I certainly have had no problem applying it to the cases before me.
Second part of my question then is, you had a defendant, Coleman, that came before you, and the defendant was convicted of selling a controlled substance and was sentenced to 15 years to life as a repeat offender. The majority of the appellate division panel and later the Court of Appeals held that the defendant was eligible for a reduced sentence under Rockefeller drug law. You disagreed. Can you tell us what was the holding of the Court of Appeals and tell us why you disagreed?
Well, once the Court of Appeals rules, I respect that court's decision. My interpretation of the statute in that case led me to the conclusion that it was that the law was not intended to apply in that particular case under those particular circumstances. Obviously, I stand corrected and respect what the Court of Appeals has decided.
Do you still disagree?
I felt that I made the best decision in my writing that I could under the circumstances. I respect what the Court of Appeals has decided.
I don't want to hammer this, but I think as somebody who worked extensively on the language of Rockefeller and its intent, it's important to me, to whomever sits, particularly on the Court of Appeals, that what decisions are rendered in relationship to that law and the intent of the law. So the nature of my question really is to get a sense of how you interpret that law, given the fact that that this reform allows the judges more discretion, which is what I won't speak for all of my colleagues because I certainly know that's not true, but which I have striven to make sure that there is as much judiciary discretion as possible under the law.
I think that one of the most difficult things that we as judges do is to try to ascertain the intent of the legislature in fashioning a particular law, particularly where there are similar statutes but applying to slightly different situations, and the language may be a little bit different, and we look to the legislative record as much as we can. Sometimes the record addresses our concerns, sometimes it doesn't. And reasonable minds certainly can differ in applying and interpreting what the legislature's intent was in enacting any particular statute or part of the statute. And we try to piece them all together, but obviously we can't step into the minds of those who enacted the laws themselves.
So I recognize then that your decision is based upon partly your interpretation, but also the facts that come before you. So in this case, you felt that because you deemed the person a repeat defender, the law then allowed you to make the decision that you then made.
Senator, as I recall that case, I must honestly say, having authored more than 750 cases as an appellate judge and having sat on many more, I can't pretend to remember exactly what the facts of each case were, but I do have a general recollection that it was not, in that case, a question of whether I felt the particular individual should or should not have been given relief under the statute, but whether, in fact, the statute applied to the nature of the crimes and the circumstances of that individual.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anyone else have any questions? Senator Diaz, but before you start, Senator, let me acknowledge Senator Kennedy has joined us. He's not a member of the Judiciary Committee, but since this is a fairly high-level Judiciary Committee today, other senators are popping in, and we welcome Senator Kennedy. Senator Diaz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Going back to what Senator Thompson asked about the ruling case. How many judges took part in that?
Well, Senator, it was either four or five. At times when we usually sit on the panel of five, but at times when we have been shorthanded, so to speak, because we have many issues on the court, we have sometimes sat on panels of four.
All the judges, you were the only one that were.
I was either one of four or one of five.
We're talking too much about reform. Do you think that the judicial system, how we elect or choose judges are appointed, should be reformed? Meaning, You're a good judge. You have great qualifications. You want to be appointed now.
I had to go with that. It was just a
Then you think in the future to pay for politicians. And you would always have, in the back of your head, worry. Anyway, come and don't like it for whatever reason. And because the police are correct, they say you might be kicked out and just from someone who happens to one power. So you think that that system of electing judges should also be reformed?
Well, Senator, that is a very important question and one that has been discussed and debated for many, many years. I have been now subject to both the elected system and the appointed system. I think that both systems can produce very well-qualified judges. I think that both systems involve some level of politics, and I don't pretend to know what the best system is. I think that that is
that was not my question. But, with all due respect, that was not.
Okay. If your question is whether that affects
decision-making. Do you think that the system in how we elect judges in the state of the ocean should be reformed?
I guess I haven't studied thoroughly all of the various options for that, and I think that it is really the legislature and the executive that have the ability to do that kind of in-depth study, and then once there is a proposal for reform, if there is, I can look at it and see if I think that it is an inclusion.
Why should you care? Appointed, nominated, whatever. How many years do I serve?
Well, if the mandatory retirement age remains at 70, I will be able to serve 12 years.
Do you think that that mandatory retirement age should be reformed?
Well, I think that the voters of the state of New York have spoken on that.
Senator Zolio.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, Judge. Congratulations on your nomination. Yes. First, an editorial comment in response to my good friend Senator Hassel Thompson's comments regarding the particular statute that you were asked about. I think the direction from the legislature was clear, as clear as mud, in terms of the direction of the different options, and basically the legislature was very divided as that measure came before for final approval, so certainly I understand the complexities that the interpreters of the law have to go through, and I wouldn't apologize for if I were you for any kind of opinion either way, because I don't believe we did our jobs as clearly as they should have been done regarding that statute. My question deals with your efforts on your resume, discuss your variety of efforts and inputs that you've put forward regarding the issues of domestic violence, the kinds of questions that you dealt with certainly as a judge, but also as a member of a number of task forces that reviewed the statutes and the issues. Although I know you are in a difficult position in terms of taking a side on a particular issue, I think it would be helpful for the members of this body to know the kinds of issues that you addressed and the kinds of priorities, if you were, in terms of questions that needed to be answered by our government.
Thank you, Senator. The issue of domestic violence is certainly one of the most significant and important issues faced by our court system and our citizenry. It's a pervasive problem that many reforms have not been successful in eradicating, but certainly it is the product of many other social and economic factors. But I think a lot of dealing effectively with the problem of domestic violence has to do with education. When I first started practicing law in 1983 in the family court, and I was assigned counsel to represent victims of domestic violence, many judges were not aware of the nature of the problem, and I think that many victims suffered because of that. Over the course of the last 30-some years, a lot has been done, a lot more education in terms of lawyers, in terms of judges, and I think that that has gone a long way to understanding, for example, why a victim might be reluctant or might refuse to press charges. There have been changes where, at one time, victims had to make a choice early on whether they went to criminal court or family court. They no longer have to make that choice. And so there have been a lot of improvements, but there continue to be areas in which I think further improvements can be made in terms of understanding the problem. Another thing that I guess I have to say, having been a participant in the Integrated Domestic Violence Park, I thought was a terrific way of ameliorating the problem of victims having to appear in multiple courts, family court, criminal court, sometimes even Supreme Court for a divorce, in order to address their problems. And with the invent of the Integrated Domestic Violence Park, that problem, and they would have to miss going to work in order to appear in each of these courts. And they needed the money to support their children and themselves. So I think a lot of improvements have been made. But as you well know, more can be done.
What type of education would you recommend going forward?
Well, I think the court system itself has done a pretty good job. And in fact, my understanding is that judges are required to take certain courses addressing that. And as co-chair of the Family Violence Task Force, we have had a group of people from around the state in different judicial positions, different court employees, making suggestions on what kind of education is needed. We've had programs recently on the language, the terminology that's used. We've had courses on immigration issues. There's just a myriad of issues that come up in this context. And we try to address as many as we can.
Thank you, Judge. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'd like to welcome Senator Stavisky, who has joined us, who's a member of the Judiciary Committee. At this point, Senator O'Malley.
Thank you, Senator. Good afternoon.
Excuse me, Senator Hoylman joined us also. Welcome, Senator. Excuse me, Senator O'Malley.
Thank you, and congratulations on your nomination. I'd like to get some feeling for your philosophy and thoughts in regards to the Constitution is strictly following either the U.S. and the New York State Constitutions, particularly in the area of the Second Amendment, and in light of the SAFE Act that is in the past and probably likely to come before the Court of Appeals before too long. If you can give us some of your philosophy and thought on construction of the interpretation of the Constitution.
Sure. Well, certainly, inasmuch as you indicated, those issues could possibly come before the court, and they will come before the court in the future. I can't speak too specifically about that, but I can say that that I certainly recognize that the Second Amendment gives people the right to own guns, and also gives the right of the state to reasonably regulate that ownership. I would certainly study and view the case law interpreting the Constitution on this issue and do my best with all the resources available to me to reach the legally correct result on whatever case would come before me in that regard.
Thank you.
Senator Perkins.
Mr. Chair. Appearing before us, I want to go back to Senator Thompson's concerns about Rockefeller drug laws. Not necessarily to focus on them, but to focus somewhat on what it represents in terms of how such laws sort of embody a kind of racial profiling implication, if not in fact explicit. And in some communities, these are very serious situations, and we see them daily in demonstrations and whatnot throughout our communities. So I just kind of want to get your sense of this racial profiling that sometimes is embodied in legislation that people protest or, as in the case of the Rockefeller drug laws, seem to have an inclination towards a bias, so to speak, towards certain communities. Have you had any thoughts about that kind of uproar that's taking place? I know you've seen the posters and the demonstrations. They're essentially about the judicial system, those of you who we are honored to have representing us in that system and making decisions, and in those decisions, representing some fairness and some understanding of what is. So how grounded or how aware are you of some of that drama that's taking place?
Well, Senator, it would be hard not to be aware.
Okay, I'm glad you said that. That's a good way to start. Because if you said you weren't, then I'd have to.
No, I certainly am aware. I think these are extremely important issues. I am very happy that they are being looked at so closely now. I'm sorry that the problems have arisen that have led to us having to do that. But certainly it's very timely and it's very important. I am aware that the governor has presented some proposals to change the system in that regard. I do not think that it would be appropriate for me to comment on that. I think our process is such that that the legislature and the executive will study and work through those issues and put forth a legislation that you all think is appropriate. And if the matter, of course, would come before me, I would approach it with an open mind, and I would attempt to apply the law in a way that complied with the legislative intent in enacting any such law.
Sure. So just I appreciate your remark, your response. I just know that there's a concern, especially in districts like mine, about judges having a bias towards supporting police, no matter what. And that obviously creates an uproar because folks feel that the system, they're cynical about the integrity of the system. But what are we gonna tell them after we vote you in, but that you said that can give them some confidence that you won't contribute to that cynicism and disrespect?
Well, you can certainly tell them that I view each and every case with an open mind. I have I look to interpret the laws impartially and to apply them fairly to everyone, whether a police officer, a victim of a crime, or any other litigant that would appear before me. I make no differential. I look at the facts of the case and I try to apply the law fairly.
Thank you.
Any other questions? I'd like to ask you some questions, just like. We in the legislature, when we deliberate issues, we have members of certain political and philosophical persuasions when we try to pass laws. And maybe a reflection of those questions, a part of those processes that we do in the legislature. And I think what we all seek is a judge that's independent, that's open-minded, will be fair, and will call the shots as they see them, and doesn't come with a political or a philosophical persuasion that we almost know how that judge is going to rule based on their past history. That's what we always hope to achieve. So I'm going to ask you some questions about cases you've decided, okay? And I'd like you to share with me your tendencies with respect to them. But before I do that, I'd ask you the first simple question. When a governor puts forth a nominee where there are several in competition, and the governor picked you, in a fight between the governor and the legislature, are you beholden to the governor in that decision, or would you be independent and call it as you see it?
Of course he's going to.
That's my first question.
When you started by saying this is an easy question, I thought, uh-oh. But indeed, Senator, it is a very easy question. I have certainly been the product, as I said earlier, of being appointed and elected by various officials in the past, and that has never impacted on my decision-making.
I'm going to ask you about the case you decided, New York State Superfund Coalition versus the New York State DEC. It was decided in September in 2009. And I don't know if you're fuzzy about the facts, because you have so many cases before you. So I don't expect you to remember all the facts. But as I read that case, it was home rule versus a DEC decision that was contrary to home rule. Home rule, local versus state agency. That was the battle. Happens all the time in a variety of ways. And I've been seeing your cases, you have a tendency to always embrace the state agency over the other side, whatever it may be. Could you talk to that a little bit, or in general, how you feel one way or the other?
Certainly. One of the basic tenets of appellate law, because it really wasn't until I became an appellate division judge that I had the opportunity to address administrative decisions. And I can say that for almost every new judge that comes on to the bench, we look to do what we think is the legally correct and right thing, and I always do that. But one of the first things that we learn is that we as judges are required to give deference to administrative decisions, particularly factual decisions, not necessarily legal decisions. We view those independently. And so we must do that unless we find that their factual determinations are irrational or arbitrary and capricious. And so that limits what we as judges can do in reviewing those decisions. Now, when it comes to a legal question, then we analyze the law, the statute, as we would in any other case. And I'm pretty certain that if you review the totality of the cases that I've sat on and are authored, there have been some cases in which I, or the majority on which I sat, have in fact reversed a factual decision of an administrative agency, but those cases admittedly are few. On the other hand, when it comes to a legal decision, there is no deference to the agency.
That leads me into my next subject, fracking. Both the health commissioner and the DEC has prohibited, they haven't prohibited, they've said fracking is unsafe, and the government says no fracking will take place in the state of New York at this time. Now, between the lines, they're basically saying that their ruling is constitutional. And I'm not asking you how you would decide, but this will come before you in time. There are many property owners that felt that that decree basically was a condemnation without compensation, a taking of property rights, therefore unconstitutional. In view of what you said about a preference for administrative rulings, would you agree with me that the U.S. and the state constitution would prevail in that case over administrative rulings if the facts so inclined?
Absolutely, and that is really in accordance with what I had indicated, which is if it's a legal, and certainly a constitutional question is a legal question, then the legality, the constitutionality is what is primary.
Okay, and do you think that in looking at that constitution that the activities in other states would have a bearing on this issue, or you would focus your analysis to the U.S. and the state constitution? And what I mean, what other states have done in allowing certain actions pertaining to fracking. I'm just curious if that would be a part of your deliberation, or would you solely concentrate on state and U.S. constitution? And keep in mind, I'm not asking to lean one way or the other, nor I haven't told you how I feel about fracking. But I know this is a very important economic issue, and there's both sides of the aisle on this one. So I'm asking you, would you look at the Constitution, and if you felt it was unconstitutional, would that preempt an administrative ruling?
Oh, there's no question about that.
Okay. Now let me ask you one more case that you did. Okay, one more case. This was People versus Weaver in 2008. Let me just tell you a little bit about it. This was a case where law enforcement put a GPS tracking system on a vehicle that was parked in a public street. Okay? There was federal law that said this was allowed, that car owner did not have an expectation of privacy at that point. That came before you in the appellate division, and you were a dissenting judge on that decision, where you did not agree with the federal ruling, and you disagreed with a majority of your appellate division judges on that issue. I will tell you that I always have a fear of judges that are judicial activists. I'm a strict constructionist. If ever I would become a judge, I would hope they would respect the intent of the laws as the legislature make them and give credence to the laws, not go off and say, I didn't like what the legislature did. I didn't like that law. I'm going to make my own law through judicial activism. I'm not saying that this case is that, but it has the seeds of that. And I will ask you to tell us a little bit about your feeling about judicial activism and your thinking in that particular case.
I certainly wouldn't consider myself a judicial activist, and it is not a part of my judicial philosophy to do as you say. My judicial philosophy is that I simply view each case with an open mind, that I attempt to impartially interpret and fairly apply the laws as they exist, as they have been enacted by the legislature, giving consideration and deference to the legislative intent, and to reach what I believe to be the legally correct result. In Weaver in particular, it's not that I didn't agree with the federal law, it was that I did not feel that I felt that the particular facts and circumstances of this case, which were that a GPS device was placed on a car and left there. In other words, that it wasn't a matter of just being in a car. It was a matter of essentially being followed when there weren't even police in the car behind you following. I felt that there was a distinguishable factor to this case that distinguished it from the other cases that had been interpreted by federal courts. And I felt that the that the New York Constitution and the federal Constitution supported my view on that. And in fact, I am very proud of the fact that that my position was validated not only by the Court of Appeals in a decision in which Judge Graffio was involved, but also by the United States Supreme Court in a unanimous decision that was written by Justice Scalia.
Okay. Thank you, Judge Stein. I have no further questions. Yes. Senator Mazzonio would like to ask you another question.
Judge, thank you for tolerating your patience in these questions. I hope that continues with the question I have. Article 4 of the Constitution of the State of New York talks about the executive authorities and powers and the responsibilities of the governor and lieutenant governor. That it clearly delineates when there's a vacancy in one of those items one of those positions that there is provision for succession. Not to get into all the nuances, but it's on Senator Bonasek's point that we saw a few years ago a case decided by the Court of Appeals that basically interceded and contravened the Constitution in terms of the ability to replace lieutenant governor. Reasonable minds can differ on the process, but the question I think Senator Bonasek is getting to is whether or not, for that matter or other matters, and I'm not asking you to really comment on that case, but rather comment on the applicability of the Constitution of the state to the specific facts. I remember one judge's opinion said, Court of Appeals, it said, New York has a strong governor state, so therefore a governor should be able to appoint, even though the Constitution was absent regarding that discussion at all, and in some ways contravened that decision. I always believed that that decision, if you transposed it 20 years, 30 years prior, more than that, 40 years prior, that when President Kennedy was assassinated, Lyndon Johnson succeeded from the vice presidency to the presidency. And the person that served as president of the time, or vice president of the time, was decided by the Constitution of the state of New York, or of the federal government. There was, the United States Constitution at that time required the majority leader or the Speaker of the House to succeed as vice president. That we had a similar situation in the sense of vacancies in the state, yet the court decided that the Constitution of the state of New York really would be interpreted in a way that, frankly, would be ignored. I think that's what Senator Bonasek is getting to in terms of his questioning, and that's what I'm getting to in terms of my questioning. How do you look at the Constitution of the state of New York, as you have had to do as an appellate judge? And when have you felt the need to deviate from the letter of the Constitution?
I don't think that I've ever felt the need to deviate from the letter of the Constitution. I think that sometimes it's just not clear what the letter is calling for. Mm-hmm. And in every case that has ever come before me and that will ever come before me, I will look at the Constitution. I will look at how it has been interpreted by the United States Supreme Court or by the court, the highest court of this state, the Court of Appeals, and I will certainly apply the Constitution as I understand it to what I understand it to mean.
I guess we can't ask for much more than
In this discussion, thank you for addressing the issue and remembering the issue as you have to deliberate.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Does anyone have any other questions of Judge Stein? Judge Stein, I think you handled yourself very well. I think you're going to be a great Court of Appeals judge. I thank you for coming here and addressing the Judiciary Committee. I'm now going to call the question on Judge Stein's nomination to the floor. Senator Breslin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'm personally delighted that after sitting on this committee for 18 years, I'm still believing it's the most important and the most thoughtful that the governor sought to this nomination to provide someone who went from being Phi Beta Kappa to second year law school class to become a law clerk, to be an appointed city court judge, an elected city court judge, onto the Supreme Court, and then onto the appellate division. Intersecting that was some plus 10 years in private practice. And I have had cases with Leslie Stein. I have known her for in excess of 25 years, and I have found her to have exemplary ability to do the right thing, to sort through the processes of deciding cases, to do it objectively, without any bias whatsoever, and to make the right decision. Some of those decisions have not pleased me, and I'm sure will not please other people in this room, but you can rest assured they will be done based upon the law. So it's my pleasure to move the nomination of Leslie Stein to become Court of Appeals judge.
Thank you, Senator Breslin. We have a second. Second by Senator Hassan Thompson. Anyone else would like to speak before we vote? Okay. Okay. On the question of Judge Stein's nomination to the floor, all those in favor, raise their hand. Say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? It's unanimous. Congratulations, Judge Stein. This nomination will go to the floor this afternoon for you to be confirmed by the legislature. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator.
Before I call Judge Fahey in, that vote was 16-0, including proxies. Now we're going to continue and ask Judge Fahey to come in and address the committee.
Do they own it?
I would ask those that want to have a conversation to take it outside the chambers because we still have Judge Fahey. We want to hear from him, please. Okay. Judge Fahey, thank you for your patience.
Yeah.
Welcome today, this afternoon. I know you were here this morning, and now you're here this afternoon.
Thank you, Senator.
Why don't you tell the committee a little bit about yourself?
Thank you, Chairman Bonasek, Senator Haskell Thompson, and members of the Senate Judiciary Committee. Before I begin today, I would like to recognize and thank my wife, Colleen Maroney, and my daughter, Ann Fahey, who are here today with me. Along with my dedicated judicial staff, Michael Pastrick and Mary Welsh, and my lifelong friend, Leonard Skrill, who ran my first campaign for councilman in 1977, so I thought I would invite him here today. I am deeply honored that Governor Andrew Cuomo has nominated me to the State Court of Appeals. I understand that this is a special privilege and a great opportunity to serve the people of the state of New York as a member of our highest court. Further, I would like to acknowledge the outstanding career of retiring Judge Robert Smith, whom I've been nominated to replace. My background is like that of many of you here. My dad was a police captain who worked his way up to become a captain in the Buffalo Police Department. My mother was an account clerk in the Board of Education. I'm the oldest of six children, and we are all from Buffalo's old First Ward, the waterfront area of our city. I attended Catholic grammar schools and high school at St. Joseph's Collegiate Institute. After that, it was the University of Buffalo for undergraduate school, supporting myself by working a variety of jobs from washing dishes in all-night restaurants to driving a cab. Early on in life, I was attracted to public service. As a young man, about age 13, Senator Robert Kennedy came to speak at the University of Buffalo during his 1964 Senate campaign. As he was leaving, one of his bodyguards, my father's friend, police officer Al McDonald, stopped the senator, and he pulled me out of the line, shook my hand, and gave me a wink. At that point, like many a young person, I was affected with the mission for public service as a way to a meaningful life. My path to the law wasn't as direct as some past nominees. I was elected a councilman. I was the first elected official in the city of Buffalo at age 25. I served a number of positions as a district member, an at-large member, and majority leader in the city of Buffalo. During that time, I graduated from law school and later received a master's degree in history. Both of these were also from the University of Buffalo. After graduating from law school, I was appointed by Court of Claims Judge Edgar Niemeyer to be his law clerk. In 93, I also ran for mayor, and I lost, which is probably my wisest career move. And I'm sure of that. And the following year, I was elected to Buffalo City Court. 2 years later, in a contested election, I was elected to State Supreme Court and then reelected again in 2010. I was the first appointed to the Appellate Division 4th Department by Governor Pataki, and then reappointed by Governor Patterson and then Governor Cuomo. Before my time on the bench, I did have a private practice, primarily doing defense negligence work. I tried cases throughout Western New York and argued appeals both at the Appellate Division and the Court of Appeals. Beyond my background, I would like to just briefly discuss with the committee my idea of the kind of judge that I hope to be on a daily basis. About 20 years ago, I argued a case at the Court of Appeals that involved a relatively minor slip and fall case dealing with the simple question of notice. The judges there were uniformly well prepared. They were impressive, exhibiting legal qualities that at that point I could only aspire to. Even after being a judge for almost 20 years, it remains a daily goal to avoid what I consider the judicial cardinal sins, impatience and laziness. A judge should always strive to temper justice with mercy and to remember, but for fortune's grace goes any one of us. The core of a job of judging is to provide a sound opinion. Every decision should reflect a careful understanding of the facts in the record and the issues raised. Reasoning must be logical, principled, and persuasive. An opinion should state the decision of the court in clear language, and it must be limited to those issues that were actually brought before the court. Finally, a decision should be rooted in precedent and committed to intellectual honesty. However, the New York Court of Appeals strives for more than that. It is where we as New Yorkers seek to have our disputes and aspirations converted to action through the power of words. This process applies to judges equally, whether in the majority or the dissent. The majority outlines its perception of the correct path to follow, and a dissent should point out the weaknesses within an opinion, and most importantly, point to a way to move forward in future cases. The New York State Court of Appeals is one of the oldest continuing functioning courts rooted in a democratic system. It has time and time again been in the forefront of the evolution of the American legal system. The court is part of an unbroken tradition of jurisprudence that has guided the development of the law since the founding of our republic. Throughout the state, all of our courts are public expressions of our daily attempts at self-government. They exist to nurture the just application of the law, To paraphrase the great historian Reinhold Niebuhr, courts advance the capacity for justice, which is what makes democracy possible. The Court of Appeals stands at the center of our legal institutions. These institutions build and preserve the values of a free society. I can think of no greater honor as a judge than to be seriously considered to serve on this court. I thank the committee for its time and consideration.
Thank you, Judge Fahey. Any questions of Judge Fahey? Okay, hearing none, I guess Senator Thompson has a
question. Sorry about that.
No, not sorry. We welcome it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Judge Fahey, I'd like to ask you a little bit, just a couple questions. Everybody's aware of the Eric Garner case. And this case has raised questions for me and several others about circumstances where should the court release grand jury information to the public? Could you tell us why secrecy is important to the grand jury proceeding and whether or not public disclosure is desirable to restore trust in troubling presentments such as the Garner case?
Thank you, Senator. Because that issue is one that may appear in front of the court, most likely it will in one form or another, and also the structure of the grand jury, I couldn't comment directly on it. I do understand the chief judge is releasing some recommended changes shortly. I'm not sure when, but I know that Judge Lippman has talked about it, and it's been in the New York Law Journal, discussing some changes to the grand jury structure. And I couldn't comment because of the nature of the issue directly on it.
Okay.
Unfortunately, many of the issues that the Senate is confronted with fall into that category for me on the Court of Appeals.
Okay, I had one other question. Is there anybody else that has questions? Yes, okay. You go and then
does
I'll come
anyone
back.
Else have any questions? So let me, I have a couple for you.
Yes, Senator.
Before I ask you a question, I just wanted to share my thoughts on someone going to the Court of Appeals. And you, by the way, will be the fourth person that I have reviewed as chairman of Judiciary. I think that that position of the Court of Appeals is more important than any of us sitting around this table or a governor.
Not today to me. You were much more important to me today, Senator, than I am to you, let me tell you, you know? Maybe tomorrow, but not today.
When they get
exactly.
Because you will endure longer than most likely the political lives of elected officials and the governor. And you being one of seven will make the decisions that'll affect thousands and thousands of lives for a generation or maybe generations to come. So we consider this a very important process that we try to always get the best of the best when we make these recommendations to the floor. Now, in my way of thinking, we need checks and balances. It's very important. So I ask you, do you consider yourself beholden in any way to this governor?
No.
In any of his rulings when it comes to whether it's the legislature versus the governor or administrative policies of the governor that land in front of you on constitutional issues, will you call him as you see him?
I will, Senator. You have my word on that.
And my second question is, do you consider yourself a activist judge or a strict constructionalist?
Well, I don't think judicial activism has any role to play in my legal philosophy. I think that I wouldn't say I was either one of those things, but more importantly, I think that the legislature makes the laws, the governor administrates or executes the laws, and the role of the judiciary is to interpret the law. And that's my goal and basically my legal philosophy and how I should approach it. I'm not afraid to tell anybody they're wrong. whether it be the governor or the Senate. I do that without fear or favor and with respect, but I do not think activism is any place to play in the role of the judiciary.
Does any other member on the judiciary, Senator Zeldin?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Congratulations, Judge.
Thank you, Senator.
I'd like to report to the committee that from the Fourth Department, both judges and practitioners have contacted me and universally praised the appointment of Judge Fahey to the Court of Appeals, that it has an honor to work with him, as described by a number of his colleagues on the bench, as well as lawyers who have had to appear before him. Judge, I appreciate that we'll have another Western New York perspective on the bench. I think it's extremely important that we have, we're one state, but we certainly have a point of view in the western part of the state, and I appreciate you now joining Judge Pigott to bring that point of view to your opinions. But to follow up on Senator Bonasek's question, respect for the Constitution and understanding the role of the court in interpreting the Constitution, not rewriting the Constitution, is what you just said. And I appreciate that comment very much in response to Senator Bonasek's question. And that if we leave you with anything, it's that there are those of us who wish you to do your job, do it well, but do it within the construct that you just articulated. The role of the courts is not to write the law, but to interpret that law.
Let me say, Senator, thank you. I have to say, first off, all of you are here, and during this process, for someone like me, this is not something you ever expect in life. And so to be considered for the Court of Appeals is a very special thing. And everyone's said the same thing to me. They just expect me to do my job. The governor, everyone I've talked to, the staff people, I think that there's respect for the institution itself, and all of us as judges, when we go there, they're looking for us to preserve that and to treat it with that respect so you can nurture it. And because, as you said, Senator Bonasek, you're stepping into history now. This is a large stage, and a lot is expected of us.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Bruce.
Any other members have anything else to say? If not, Senator Kennedy, who is not a member of the judiciary, has to come here because of friendships and the highest respect he has for you, would like to make some remarks.
First of all, let me thank Chairman Bonasek for the graciousness of giving me an opportunity to speak, as well as the ranker, Senator Ruth Hessel Thompson. I appreciate it very much. Judge, welcome. Colleen and Ann, welcome. This is obviously an extraordinary day for you, Judge, and your family, but a day that you have worked very hard for, and despite the fact that you said that it's unexpected in your life, you have certainly earned this opportunity. One just has to look at your resume to recognize, in Senator Bonasek's words, I believe you to be the best of the best. And that's not just because you're from my district.
But it helps. That helps, you know.
And you're a Buffalonian, and it certainly helps. And not, certainly not because, just because you went to my alma mater, St. Joseph's Collegiate Institute, high school, as well as Senator Rob Ortz, so there's a bipartisan level of respect there, but because of your dedication to our community in Western New York. As a judge in the Supreme Court, as a judge in city court, as an elected official, as a city councilman on various levels, and as a community activist, I have known you for a little over a decade, I would say, and certainly am honored to be able to call you my friend. But I've known you before that by reputation, and I think you have left an extraordinary and indelible mark on our community in Western New York. Certainly, your reputation for caring for people and helping others speaks for itself. I know that you are a man of great integrity, and you'll bring that integrity to the bench. And I look forward to voting for you on the floor of the Senate when it comes to a vote, and certainly give this committee my highest recommendation on your behalf.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator.
Chairman.
Thank you.
Pinto, our new senator from Buffalo.
Senator Bonasek, thank you very much for allowing me to speak here today. Judge Beatty, how are you?
I'm good. I'm good, Senator. Thank you.
Can you really believe you're here?
No, not really, but.
Judge, as a trial lawyer and somebody that's known you for 18 years, I'll probably be the only person in the Senate who's argued motions in front of you.
That's true.
Tried cases in front of you, argued appeals in front of you, and then really got to know you and your wife, Colleen, and Ann, and Lenny on the campaign trail in 2010. My wife was on the ballot with Judge Beatty in 2010. So we went to innumerable parades all over the 8th Judicial District, and, you know, many county fairs that year. So, you get to know somebody on the campaign trail in a different way than doing the court. And I think that you will be a tremendous asset to the bench. Your legal acumen is tremendous, and you'll be, Western New York and New York State will be well served. So I'm happy to have you here. He's proud to be on the floor today.
Thank you, Senator. Thanks a lot.
Any other senators wish to speak? Well, let me just conclude with just a couple points. Did you have time to say goodbye to the people in Buffalo? Because I understand tomorrow they'll want you sitting.
I am. I'm ready. I brought the boxes.
Judge, I know you're going to be a great Court of Appeals judge, but I have appeared in my lifetime before many judges. I've tried many cases in my lifetime over 30 years, and I also was a prosecutor in the DA's office. And from all of the accolades that we've heard throughout the state about you, from the various bar associations, I think the highest compliment you can tell a judge is that he will be a judge's judge. And I think you have those qualities, and I would hope that you would be a judge's judge on the Court of Appeals. So having said that, I'm going to ask, can I have a nomination? Senator Mazzolio, do I have a second?
Second.
Second, Senator Hassan Thompson. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All those, nobody opposed? Congratulations.